Student Affairs and the Office of Inclusion, Diversity, Equity, Access, and Support. I'm Dr. Julia Bernard, and we are pleased to welcome Lieutenant Colonel Enoch Woodhouse to campus. He is one of the last surviving Tuskegee Airmen, and it is an honor to have him with us here today. Please help me in welcoming Lieutenant Colonel Enoch Woodhouse.
Is everyone here that's supposed to be here?
Raise your hand if you're not.
You know, it's an honor to be here in Norwich, to be surrounded with so many fine young men and women that will be the future leaders of America. The future leaders of America. You know, I was thinking why I was invited here. February happens to be Black History Month. And I said to myself, who are the coincidence? Inviting me Black History Month, who are the coincidence? Why me? Why not you? Well, I always had to file a disclaimer. I'm not here to talk to you about Black history. I'm here to talk about American history. That's what I'm interested in. American history, our history. Now, in our lives, we always have some event or date that really sticks with our minds. Now, the older generations, I don't think anyone's here, I'm 95 2 weeks ago, that will remember the day of infamy, December 7th, 1941. Younger generation, 9/11, that's the big thing. But for my generation, Tom Brokaw wrote a book, The Greatest Generation. And why was it the greatest generation? The greatest generation, because we all worked together. We sacrificed together. There were no parties. There was no distinction. When we graduated as every person, Black, white, Italian, Syrian, or what, you had your high school diploma in hand. Your diploma in hand, the ink's not dry. And you went to two places. You went to the Fuller Building, which was for the Army, and you went to the Fargo Building, which is still used and still in existence, few modifications, if you're Navy or Marine Corps. Those are the only two places. Some, I went when I was 16 and a half, barely 17. Some went as low as 15. Can you imagine 15 years old forging your parents' names to fight and die so you could be sitting here, so you could study here? Now, why are you here? Why were you selected to come here? According to the statistics, there were three other men and women, young boys and girls, that wanted to come here. They couldn't make the cut. You made the cut. So you're given a privilege to be here. You're given an opportunity to work your tails off, to sacrifice, to give up the Game Boys, to give up the roulette games, to hit the books, study, sacrifice. Now, I just left the luncheon. Now, I had a wonderful lunch. Tiramisu for dessert, and this and that. And you know, I was talking to one of the senior faculty members and said, gee, what wonderful food you serve the students at Norwich every day, in every meal. And I could imagine Eggs Benedict for the breakfast and catered meals. But you know, you have an opportunity, so take advantage of it. Now, you take advantage of it, that requires sacrifice. Now, who was my sacrifice? When I enlisted, when my mother told us, boys, December 7th, we're at war. I want you boys to fight for our country. Fight for our country. This isn't my country. It's not your country. It's our country. Does anyone disagree with that? Well, we better be together, guys. Meanwhile, back in Moscow, back in Peking, people are anticipating us not to get our act together. Very simple. The fall of all great civilization, Rome, they weren't conquered by the Carthaginians or Gauls. Caesar had a group that went against him. The Egyptians had their group that went against him. So you have an opportunity to lead, and this is the best place to lead. And you know what? I have to tell you the truth. When I go to the Citadel and I go to VMI, I'm going to say the same thing about Norwich. Now, if they run me out, I'm going to come back here looking for you guys to bail me out. When I had my certificate of enlistment in, very proudly, my physical examination took exactly 3 minutes, walk through, looked at you, walk across the hall, and stamp approved. That was the physical during wartime. So we boarded the train, all of us happy, 16, 17, going to our first base in Texas, basic training in Texas, that time United States Army. So we got on the train, Boston, Chicago. We were great to be out in Chicago the first time. We had $3 or $4 in our pockets. And then from Chicago, we went to St. Louis. Still laughing, talking how we were going to save America and fight fascism and Nazism because we want freedom. And blacks still had another freedom to get, don't forget. We had to work at home when we got here. Okay, so we got to St. Louis and we were boarding the next train out to Texas. And the line at that time was MKT, Missouri, Kansas, Pacific Railroad. So we all got on the train with our duffel bags, and at that time in 44, everything you owned in the world was in a duffel bag this big, which you carried on your back. So we got on the train, ready to board, ready to pull out, and before we were pulling out, the conductor, everyone seen Archie Bunker? You know what he looks like. That's what the conductor looked like and came and tapped me on my shoulder, not too gently, "Get off the train." We're looking around, who's on the train? So he came up and tapped me, "You get off the train." A young black man in the uniform of the United States ordered to get off the train to report incidentally to its first duty station. So what happened? I got off the train. I had to get off the train. So I'm standing out there with my duffel bag, trains pulling out. A black porter came up to me. He was alone there. And he says, "Son, what are you doing here?" I said, "Well, I'm supposed to be on the train going to Texas." "Oh, son, by the way, have you ever been south before?" I said, "Well, yeah, I went to New York, you know." He said, "Well, you know, you're in the real south, and we don't ride this train. We don't ride this train. Texas, USA, America. Your America, my America. That's what happened to me. Now, I don't feel badly. I feel disappointed in America. But that doesn't make me your victim or any other victim. Because this is what makes America great, guys and gals. We stand up for what's right. We stand up what our conscience tells us to do. Oh, you'll have consequences. You'll pay. But you know, I found out that what you're asked to pay at that time, you remunerated fourfold. Good and better things happen to you when adversity, so-called adversity, comes to you. Now back to me at the train station with $4 or $5 in my pocket. I couldn't even buy a chicken sandwich or a hot dog. They wouldn't let me in the coffee shop. 17 years old, few dollars in your pocket, your uniform, ready to defend this country. I can't get a hot dog, but I'm going to my base. You haven't heard the end of it. So I asked the porter, I says, "When is the next train coming through?" He says, "Boy, the next train is coming through around 8 hours. 8 hours? 8 hours later. So I had to wait 8 hours. And that train was not the same train that I was on. This was the local train for black people in 1944 to go from point A to point B. Now, you know what happened when I got to my post almost a day late? AWOL. We were in khakis at the time. My uniform was sooty, smelly, full of dust. So I reported to my first sergeant, who was white. Can you hear me? Can you hear me back there?
Yes, sir.
So when I went back and I stood at attention to my first sergeant, and he looked like Archie Bunker's cousin. And in those days, I had never seen a black officer. The only thing I saw was one corporal. And the person laced me out was, of course, a white sergeant. And boy, did he ream me up and down. You know what I mean by ream? Do you know what that is?
Yeah.
When you're 17, you are almost 24 hours late at your post, and in wartime, you're not late for your post, you're AWOL. Absent without official leave. And the penalty for that is, can be, and usually is, execution. You desert the country in wartime, that was a penalty. So I started to explain, and didn't you know that the trains were late and I couldn't ride this train? Oh, I couldn't open my mouth. You know, in the military, you got three responses. Yes, sir. No, sir. What's the third?
No excuse, sir.
Okay, let me hear it again.
No excuse, sir.
You got it. I had no excuse, guys. I just stood there and took it. Of course, I wasn't too popular the first few days there, but I survived. Now, being black in the military, instead of companies in the Air Force, or Air Force to be, we had squadrons, not companies. So the squadron that I was assigned in, and all people of color, was Squadron F. A was administration, B was mechanics, and F was strictly blacks, duties, sole, maintenance of the base, housekeeping of the base, refueling the aircraft, driving the trucks, driving for the clubs from the flight line, and keeping the streets clean in snow removal. At that time, there was no outsourcing. Everything to be done on the base was done with local soldiers, local military. When I was there, what did I find? That was the only job I could have. That was a place where you had your class A's maybe once or twice in about the year you were there. Your uniform, being black, was not in camis but in fatigues. You didn't wear your class A's. You weren't going to the formations and base parades. Why? You were working. You had to clean the streets. You had to refuel the planes. That was what it was like in America. Now, I say that not in bitterness, because I'm not bitter. Why be bitter? When America or anyone, and this goes for you and your activities and your future positions of leadership, when you see that any person of any sex or thing is not only given the opportunity to perform to the best of their abilities, you are destroying and ruining your own mission. Now, the 99th Fighter Squadron, that was the only fighter squadron in the Air Force that was no supposed to fight enemy aircraft. Our sole mission was to protect the bombers in box formation, upper, lower, right, and left. Couple of Emmys 109s or Focke-Wulfs came by, you couldn't engage them. You had to protect the bombers. There were no crews of color on the bombers comprising 10 and 12 people. That's why blacks were mostly in fighters, because in fighter, it's only you. There was no interaction or interreaction with people of the other color. And incidentally, when we're talking about colors, I'm not black and you're not white. Now, if you look at a color chromatic plaque, you'll see the color white. I don't see anybody looking like that here. And when you see the color black, I am not chromically black. I'm a very deep, dark brown. And I'm proud of it. And I want you to be proud of what you are. And I don't want you to feel badly if you're not like me. Everyone can have everything. That's the way I look at it. I'm proud of what I am, you proud of what you are, and you know what? We all should be proud to be Americans. You know the song, I'm proud to be an American, the land of the brave and the free. That's the way I look at it. Now, when I'm talking about these bad things, there are a lot of good things that happen. How many went to luncheon? Okay, all right, now I'm gonna have to review a little thing to what I said. You were there, I hope, if I'm talking too long about this, you just say, Colonel, shut up. And if you do, Mike is gonna come looking for you. You know, when you try to do the right thing, and you try to act properly within your conscience, and within the creed or oath that you have taken, follow it through. Trust your judgment. Follow your mental attitude. And how do you get your mental attitude? You get your mental attitude here. You're training to be leaders. You're training to think. But your processes have to be within yourselves. Now people say to me, Woodhouse, what is your secret for longevity? And what is your secret? So I tell everybody, my secret is my secret. But you know what? You have your secret. If you listen to your body will tell you, you can only have two beers at one time. Now, you can have four or five or six, but when you wake up in the morning, trust me, you won't have four beers again. The person that I use always as an example, Thomas A. Hudner Jr. Naval Congressional Medal of Honor, and I hope that some of your instructors, or maybe you on your own, will Google him and research him, his life, and what he did. Now, why do I talk about great men? Because those great men give us examples. We know what great things can be done by great people. Now, there are always, not always great, there are few of us that are always honest and brave, 100% operating full throttle at all times. Very few. Most of us, 98, 99% like me, but you know, all of us are average. When that comes about, when you focus, back to Tom Hudner, he was a naval aviator from Annapolis. Shot down in Korea, Annapolis prep school, well met, well educated, and just a nice guy. He did the right thing. Now, mission over Vietnam, He was shot down.
Oh, Korea.
Thank you, Marine. You see how Marines come to our rescue?
Yeah, attention.
Any men or women going into the Marines here? You have my sympathies. Carry on. Oh. Tom Hudner's wingman was Jesse Brown, a young black naval aviator as Tom was. First, but still a naval aviator. And he was shot down in Korea. And so the wingman, which is a wingman's responsibility, not responsibility, but this is what he does naturally. It's not his duty, but this is what he felt it was the right thing to do. And your wingman is like your brother. Where you go, he goes. If you go down, if he goes down, you go down with him to follow him and see what you could do. Now, Tom just did just that. He crash-landed his plane to try to partially land it on a mountainside. Crash-landing in the mountainside in a Corsair. This a Corsair? Thank you. Crash-landed in a Corsair, which was the Navy's prime aircraft. He crash-landed his plane by Jesse's sight with an attempt to rescue and get him out of the aircraft. No good, couldn't be done. The aircraft, mangled, body, fuselage all distorted, and he just couldn't get Jesse Brown's body out because it was wedged in and against the indented metal construction of the cockpit. So Tom had to abandon that effort and call for the Jolly Green Giant, which was the rescue helicopters that would come up and rescue downed aircraft. Tom was rescued, brought back to the carrier, very elated, regretted that his buddy and wingman he had to leave that was killed. He was expecting to be, well, Tom, you did a good job and we appreciated you trying to save your wingman. That was not the case. What was the case? What was the fact? Tom Hudner, report to the captain's mast. You're in trouble. Trouble? Well, you know, guys, destruction of government aircraft, believe it or not. That's what Tom was charged with, which on an aircraft carrier is the worst thing that can happen to the captain of that carrier because one aircraft was lost. And here in Tom's case, it was not just one aircraft, but two. Boy, that's a big toll on that. So, to make a long story short, Tom's family, being well connected, went to the senator. The senator went to the president. And what happened when they got to the president, who was Harry Truman at the time, he was furious. He said, what's this? A white guy trying to rescue a black guy and we're at war and all these racial disturbances and so forth? You're gonna court-martial him? Not happening. Told his aide, get the CNO on the line. That's Chief of Naval Operations. That's the guy that oversees the entire deal. He says, CNO, not only are you not going to court-martial him, you, CNO, I'm charging with personally writing his recommendation for the award of the Congressional Medal of Honor. Isn't that something, guys? Isn't that something? When you do the right thing, someone wants to screw you around a bit. But you know what? There's always one person that sees what's going on and will do the right thing. So Tom, many of us know him personally, very humble, didn't want any recognition. In fact, you have to drag the story out of him. But that's humility, that's greatness, and that's leadership. Now, I hope during this time we might have some time for questions, comments, or... Yes.
Can I talk about this?
Yes. This is Lieutenant Colonel Mike Warbrick, alum of Norwich from 1850. and he's going to give you the... Why don't you
why
tell
don't you
him...
talk about it first.
Yes, okay, thank you, Mike. This is the Congressional Gold Medal of Honor, which was bestowed by President George W. Bush at Congress. Now, there were about 300 of us that received this medal, but I was one of the few that had this medal presented in hand by the president. Most of the people got the president handing the medal to his aide, and his aide would bestow it on the recipient. But being the devious person that I am, I was able to maneuver to the president personally. And whenever you want to find a person of interest, of note, and you want to find out which entrance they're coming into, there are 10 entrances. You just look for one. And the one you will see with men in black shirts with microphones around them. And that's the one door. Nobody knew, but you just, I was with State Department, so I know how the deal works. You stand by, and that's the exit that the president will come through. But before he comes through, they have to see that no one's standing around. So I was there. And I introduced, I said, Mr. President, I'm Enoch Woodhouse, Yale class of 52. So he laughed and gave me the medal, and so he whispered something in my ear. And we both laughed. So my other fellow Tuskegee Airmen said, gee, what did the president say? He must have said something great. Reluctantly, I had to say, all the president said to me, beat Harvard. So I wanted to circulate this around so you can see. And this, guys and gals, is the highest honor that a civilian can be bestowed upon other than Congressional Medal of Honor. And to have this, I had to bring this out, and it's within three or four wraps of plastic. And I look at it annually and cherish it. And on the front you'll see the replicas of three black airmen. And on the obverse side you'll see the three aircraft, the 47s, 51s, and B-25s, bombers. Now, you know, you hear about blacks in aviation in America. Well, we had the 477th Bomber Squadron. But you know what? We never used the bombers for some reason. Men trained for bombers. They were not used at all. We had parachuters trained at Fort Benning, jump school. They were never used. during the war. Oh, they were used after the war to fight the forest fire up in the Northwest. We have come a long ways, but you know, we have to go further. So Michael sort of, while we're talking, Mike, before you talk, oh, okay.
So be sure everyone touches it. It's really quite something. Pretty solid and get some weight to it.
So while he's circulating the coin, I want you to introduce my dear friend, Dave Anderson. Stand up, Dave, with a Norwood alum.
Oh, and, God, Norwich.
Well, you're young and hot because you give a lot of time and money to this institution. And people, if it wasn't for this guy here, I wouldn't be here. Because he invited me up two years ago to be exact, when it was a big weekend when Condoleezza Rice was here and Secret Service guys swarming all over the place to fill to capacity. So, Dave, thank you very much.
My honor.
I feel that I'm part of the Norwich group, Norwich family. And you have a wonderful institution. You have wonderful men. And I met the president today, sat in his office, and showed me what he is, and above all, what he's going to do for this institution. You know, I've seen a lot of places, but the people in Norwich, for his size, has an advantage. Because the superintendent knows each one of you clowns. He knows you all. You can't hide. Which is for your advantage. Because that makes you on your toes. And when he asks you, how are you doing in English? How are you doing in physics or math? You know, you better have a good answer for them because, and this is a tip, when you have an officer ask you how's the case or how you're progressing, he knows. He knows why you got there. So, fess up. But what's even better than fessing up, don't put yourself in a position where you have to admit your shortcomings or failures. Now, while the coin is being circulated, if anyone has any question or comment, or heaven help you, any criticism, just stand up, just raise your hand, acknowledge yourself, and we'll respond. Now, I'm not entertaining any questions for many people from VMI or the Citadel. You can get out of here. Okay, thank you.
Sir, my grandfather flew on a B-17 in World War II.
Oh, yes.
Thank you.
Oh, thank you. Well, you know, we've met many men that thanked us for saving their lives.
We talked about you guys.
You know, the 99th Fighter Squadron people was the only fighter group in the country that whose mission was not to fight fighters. Can you imagine that? Our mission was not to fight enemy aircraft, not to go after the Messerschmitts. Our mission solely was to protect the bombers. The bombers. We had box formation, and you weren't supposed to leave your formation. That was your mission. But what happened, we had one Lee Archer. He was from New York. You know how New York guys are. New York. Any New Yorkers here?
My husband.
Boy, you got a lot of nerve raising your hand. No, being from New York, It gave him a different perspective. In other words, New Yorkers do everything the New York way. This is why they call it the great city. And when we would go around, I'd meet some real old New Yorkers. And, you know, we'd talk international stuff, being abroad. You know, we asked him about London or Paris and so forth. And you'd ask some people, and you'd ask them about London, never been there. How about Rome? Never been there. How about Moscow? Never been there. I says, why haven't you been there? He said, I live in New York. We have everything. So that's the way New York is. But Lee Archer left the formation and engaged two ME-262. That was the jet. And he shot down two in 3 minutes in a piston aircraft, which was a record, a record. So, like Tom Hudner, he came back. Oh, gee, I shot down two planes. Oh, man, this is great. I can put two swastikas on my aircraft. That wasn't the case, like Tom Hudner. Colonel Davis, Captain Archer, you left the formation. You failed your mission. But, sir, no excuse. No excuse. So Lee didn't have the connections that Tom Hudner had, but Colonel Davis at that time relented. You know, it was great propaganda, a black aviator shooting down two jets in less than 3 minutes. That's good propaganda. That's good news. So that's how Lee was able to look him up. Wonderful guy. And afterwards, he had one of the best jobs in the Air Force. For his publicity and also the publicity of the U.S. government, he was given the best job that any Air Force officer could have. He was protocol officer for the United States Embassy in Paris. So his job was to escort the senators and the senators' wives on their shopping trips along Faubourg Saint-Honoré and to see that they had the hotels and so forth. So while I'm just saying this to fill in while the coin is being circulated, might keep an eye on that coin there.
Got eyes in the back of my head.
Oh, he's got eyes in the back of his head, guys, so listen up. Okay,
go ahead. Yes, sir. So if you guys couldn't fight back, I imagine the mortality rate must have been high.
Pardon?
There's a microphone.
Yeah, thank you.
If you fellas couldn't fight back, I imagine the mortality rate of the Tuskegee Airmen was pretty high. And how did you feel when someone didn't return from a mission?
Well, like the various discriminatory practices, for us that was nothing new. That was, hey, what else are they gonna do? You know, when I grew up in the 30s, I was like 6 or 7 years old. When my parents would show me the newspapers, right, they'd try to hide them, but I'd see them. There were people, black people, being hung up on a tree. And people around clapping and applauding. It was a festival. It was a picnic to go out and see the hanging of the N-word. So I was shielded from that, but yet I was told to continue on. Things are better, but they still have a way to go. Now, everyone I talk to says, oh, Woodhouse, you should be happy. We have laws outlawing discrimination. We had the case of Brown versus Board, which is another story. I'll do that next year. Brown versus Board of Education.
Tell them that story, Woody. Yeah, please.
Okay. Brown versus Board of Education. Everyone's heard of that case, how it ended segregation, how it made races equally, and how it abolished discrimination and discriminatory practices, how you could buy a house if you had the money, all of those good things, hinged on this decision, which was not unanimous, but prohibited discrimination in public education. That's what the case decided. Discrimination in public education. This didn't mention barring blacks from golf courses, municipal golf courses, residential districts, private education, private professions, and believe it or not, even cemeteries. There were some countries, and of course, interracial marriage. Brown versus Board had nothing to do with that. So the takeaway, people, is every element of discrimination that was removed, every element, remember, swimming pools, cemeteries, public accommodations, public transportation, every one of those activities that would be involved by me had to be litigated up to the Supreme Court. And litigating up to the Supreme Court, if you have the money, and if you had the time, which is usually 5 or 6 years before the court would hear your case. So that's when we say progress. It was incremental progress. One step, two steps, three steps, one step behind. So you're still at two steps. So this is the way it's gone. So please don't have the illusion that discrimination in all elements in America for people of color, and now Hispanics, now Asians, now LSBQs, everyone that's subject to any discrimination or unfair labor practice, that point has to be eliminated and litigated individually on a case-by-case basis. So that's why when people say, well, Woodhouse, are things getting better? Yeah, things are getting better in public education. But what about the other things? But then we have to even go back into public education, because we all know our schools are segregated. We all know that why people of color, Hispanics, don't make the service academies in places like Norwich is because they cannot pass the examination. But why can't they pass the examination? Because they don't have the advantage of the fourth, fifth, and sixth grade. Now, my own example, I went to Boston English High School, the oldest public high school in America. We're doing our bicentennial 2 years. Keep an eye on my coin back there. I see, raise your hand where it is. Oh, okay, all right, keep eyes on him back up there. No, I'm just joking.
I wanted to make sure I didn't want to touch it. It didn't go all the way back earlier, so I started it from the back going forward.
See, this Marine has eyes in the back of my, in the back of my head, his head, not mine. Where was I? Oh, about discrimination. It happens that when people are discriminated against, you can have several options, several areas of activity. You can write a letter to your senator or congressman. Yeah, lots of luck. Your letter is not likely to be received well or received at all. You can, quote, raise hell, unquote. That means strike or do something violent. The thing I like to think that will be more successful is basically do nothing at that instance, but just do your best in your activity. Now, Woodhouse, how do you get this weird philosophy? Well, you know why? This is naturally how I think. If someone slaps me on the cheek, hey, I'm not going to turn the other, I'm going to let them have it. Or I'm going to slit his tires when he's parked outside my girlfriend's house. Or I'm going to give an unfavorable tweet on him. You know, there are a lot of things you can do, but you're doing that to him, and you're not helping yourself.
That microphone, now, the microphone for the question. No.
Oh, are there any questions from the group here? Did I see a hand over there? No, I guess someone was scratching their head. Okay.
Sir, I got a quick thing for you over here.
Yeah.
My name's Mark Andrew. I work in Jackman Hall, class of 2045. Everyone, I encourage you to ask questions. Colonel Woodhouse and I had a great conversation in my office this morning. And, sir, thank you again for that call, but also for being here at Norwich University. We're very, very, very fortunate and honored to host you. You had shared a story with me that I really would appreciate you to share with the larger audience as quickly as you could about the Daunting Inferno book. Because we talk about caring for our people, getting to know them in a personal way so we can best advocate for their success. And the story, I thought, was just beautiful. So if you wouldn't mind, as we're waiting for the next question, to share that.
Yes. You know, while Superintendent and I were in his office, we were talking about many things, and I think you were all privileged to have such a leader as you have. And his leader was not picked out of the want ads. It was selected rigorously several times by the Board of Trustees. And I'm saying this knowing institutions, how things work. Good things start from the top. And all you have to do is just stay the course. Go to your lectures, go to your class. We were talking about Dante's Inferno. That to me is another book. And people taking English, go to the library. Read something that you don't have to do. Now, what happened to me? Why do I get by and ignore not injustices, but slurs, embarrassments, uncomfortable feelings? You can't let that go to heart. Now, what also always comes to my mind whenever things happen to me is I think of the lines of Dante. And in Italian, I say it is non ragionam di lor, ma guarda e passa. I'll repeat. Non ragionam di lor, ma guarda e passa. Now, Dante was in the Inferno by Virgil, showing him the evil people, people that have done things to evil other people, priests that have debauched nuns, embezzlers, anarchists. And so when Dante was passing, he was looking at all of these people. This one did this, Epstein was this, and whatever did this, and all of these real obnoxious people that we don't want to mention or even be around. So those lines have stuck with me, and I think of them every day. When you see evil, or people doing evil things, don't discuss them. Don't think about them. But look, guarda, and pass on. Guarda e passa. Isn't that beautiful? You see someone doing something bad, just look at them, okay. Look at them and pass on. And so when you pass on, you pass on to positive thinking. You're positioning yourself to be in a better area of what I like to be in always, positivity. Positivity. You know the old saying, you got lemon, make lemonade. People ask me, well, gee, you were at Yale at 4 years? No one would room with you? You didn't see a black on the campus for 4 years? No black professor, instructor, not even a black waiter? How did you stand it? Well, you know, you make lemon out of lemonade. I couldn't get a roommate, so Yale had to find me a suite. Sweet. Of course, you know, our universities are supposed to be democratic, okay? Yale and Harvard and the Ivories, they all have special suites for the heavy hitters. They don't, I was living across the Gimbel twins, Dick and Richard. The Gimbel stores. Everyone heard of Gimbel's department stores in New York? They're biggies. I was up the hall from them. Each of them had a suite. And Bob Gimbel, which he wanted me to call her, she had us go down and had coats, three polo coats, made up for her boys. Across the hall from me was a melon. Okay, Mellon. Well, he came up for his suite in a chauffeured limousine. And he had the chauffeur driver throw out all of the furniture in his suite and put in new stuff. And then after he did that, and when they dropped it out, they just left it in the hall. If I had dropped the paper, Mr. Woodhouse, remember where you are. You know, drop the whole stuff there. And then the thing that really got me, the driver unpacked his suitcase. Come on, give me a break. You know, but, you know, look and pass on. But the moral, the takeaway from that, people, is that when people try to give you the shaft, suck it up. Something good's gonna happen. But you gotta hang around. I'm 95, still hanging around. Yeah. Any more questions? Any more questions?
Modern day questions?
Yeah.
What's his secret to making it to 95?
Well, didn't you hear what I said earlier? I said, my secret is my secret. No, my secret is what you have is your secret. When your body tells you, a very simple analogy, when your body tells you, you can only have 2 beers tonight. If you have 2, plus a vodka, plus a couple of whiskey shots, your body's gonna give you a message in the morning. and the message will be in your head, because it won't be where it's supposed to be, and it won't be stationary. It'll be floating. I'm saying that from reading in the book. It never happened to me. Yeah, did you have a question? Oh, you're just leading forward. Okay.
So, if I can ask a question.
Yes.
I'm curious, you know, in your 95 years, you've seen a lot of history, and I'm curious what your favorite historical moment has been.
I didn't get the last part, Colonel.
What has been your favorite historical moment?
Other than getting married, my wife's not here. I say, other than getting married, my wife's not here.
Other than getting married.
Ah, thank you. My great moment was to be at the dedication of the barracks built in marble granite at West Point, which is the most impressive and imposing building at West Point. And being the paymaster from Colonel Davis, I was given a special invitation to attend dedication of the barracks, which is, you know, an enormous building. And after the dedication, to answer your question, what was the greatest moment, I was invited, get this, people, I was invited to stand by the superintendent at the pass-by review of the entire Corps of Cadets. Entire Corps of Cadets. And to stand by him, that was an honor, because it wasn't just me, but I thought of the building dedicated in honor of Colonel Davis, who had been given the silent treatment previously for 4 years. It just showed me, just hang in there, do what you're gonna do, don't haggle with people, just look and pass on. I think of the time that, you know, I felt bad, you know, when I couldn't get a roommate and I thought they would put me down in the cellar at Yale. Hey, I got a suite. I hung in. This is what we want for you, Mr. Woodhouse. You accept it. And the three words I always say to every group that I say, just three words. Just let's hear it again. Suck it up. Suck it up.
Suck it up.
Suck it up.
Suck it up.
That's your secret.
Woody, I know it's habit that you know Colonel Davis is Colonel Davis. You might want to remind them what he retired as and when he got his.
Oh, yes. That's it. Thank you. Thank you, Mike. You know, Colonel Davis, he was the commander of the 99th Fighter Squadron in Europe, North Africa, Ramatelli, Capitacino, all those places. Now, he was one of the few colonels that was commander of an air base, and there was no suitable housing on the base. They had to rent a farmhouse from him off the base. So when he left the base for lunch, he had to leave, go home and have lunch and come back, go home and come back. And being the only colonel on the base, the only full colonel, one lieutenant colonel, the Davises had no children. They were basically a lonely, solitary couple. So I guess that's how, being used to the silent treatment he had at West Point for 4 years, you know, this was just part of his making. So,
what did he retire as?
Oh, to answer you, well, thanks, Mike. He retired as a three-star general. Three stars. Really? And that was, you know, just awesome. And, you know.
Did he ever get a fourth star?
I don't think so.
President Clinton?
No, I don't think he got a fourth. He did?
He was retired, but he got it as
president. Oh, okay. Thank you. Well, you want to clear that up to the group? Yeah, go ahead. This is my brother. He's going to pick up where I left off. Stand up, Mike. You're at home here, even though you don't know your way around.
I'm on track, so he doesn't go down a rabbit hole too far. I'm Nick Webb, class of 88. I think through habit, as you can imagine, refers to Colonel Davis, Colonel Davis, Colonel Davis. Colonel Davis went on to be a 3-star general in the Air Force and retired. Just like General McGee, who just passed the day after Woody's 95th, 3 weeks ago, was given a 1-star by President Trump. Lieutenant General Davis was given, or brought out of retirement by President Clinton, and given his 4th star to be the first 4-star black general. So, trying to get him there, because he remembers him from back in the day when he was just a full bird. I won't say just a full bird general. He was the only commanding, base commander in the United States in the 40s and 50s, black colonel. So, like you said, American history.
Yeah.
Carry on.
Yeah, just to pick up where Mike was saying about the other star, and he was Colonel, later General by Trump, McGee. They had his memorial service 10 days ago. McGee, he was the only fighter pilot in Air Force history that saw actual combat service in all 3 wars, World War II, Korea, and Vietnam. Now, with all of that combat experience, about 3,000 or 4,000 hours, he was still a colonel, 06. And President Trump got him his 4th star. Of course, it really wasn't President Trump that did that, but President Obama had proposed that 4 years earlier, but it had been postponed, postponed, postponed. Now, Colonel McGee's favorite story, like you asked me my historic moment. Captain McGee was IP instructor pilot, and one candidate, you know, was a little sloppy and he was going to be washed out. But he came to Captain McGee and said, you know, can you help me and so forth. So Captain McGee gave him assist, not a heads up, but an assist, put in a good word to the flight surgeon, and he was certified. He got back on flying status. Now, his name was, I think, Grissom or Alan Shepard, the astronaut. It was one of those two astronauts. You can look me up. Look up what I said about having one man make a difference in the national career of a national hero without getting recognition. I think it was Grisham, but you know, the name is not important as the individual and the importance of giving someone a chance, putting someone over the hill, or tipping the scales in a person. And this happened to me. You know, I was a lowly waiter. You know, nobody saw anything of me, but someone did. And I'd just like to wind up, you know, guys, when I'm here with you, I feel at home. Because I want to share with you my experiences. I'm 95. I've been down the road, but I know you guys are coming up. And regardless of who you are, you may not like me, but I like you. I want to help you. The only reason, the main reason why I'm helping you is others have helped me. And all of us are Americans here. As far as I can see, I don't see any spies. Everybody here, we're supposed to be one team and one group. And when I can get in your hearts that you're here for a reason. You're here for a purpose. Now, if I was in your situation, if a guy like me came, man, I'd be writing notes, I'd be, you know, listening attentive, what you've done. But I just want you to take advantage, not just of me, but I know you will have other speakers here, others. And, you know, some guy you don't know, you happen to know me, you know, Black History Month, that's good. But whenever you have a free time between classes, don't miss classes, because like I said, the class you missed, I guarantee that's the question that's going to be on your exam. It happens to me. That's what happens. That's why the teacher tells you go to class every day. That happened to me twice in law school, and it will never happen again. I don't miss classes. I have notebooks. I carry notebooks. And, you know, I hate to be talking all the time, but while I'm here, it's like you people are thirsty. You're thirsty for knowledge. That's why you're here. You can get information, but there's a difference between information and knowledge. You can get information about how to stack a deck of cards, or how to, how's the word? What do you do to dice? You load the dice, that's what it is. Or any illegal stuff. That's information. But knowledge is information that's permanent and that will carry you throughout your life, not just for your 4 years here. We're preparing you to leave. In any branch, activity, or industry, you feel that you're capable of working. I mean, I don't know what you want to do. And to be honest, I don't think most of you know what you want to do. Am I right? Am I right, guys? Does everybody here know what they want to do when they get their paper in hand? You know? Do you know?
Yes, sir.
Okay, well, you're fortunate. You're fortunate. Well, I wish you success, and I'm sure if you know, you're ahead of the game. And your friend behind you knew what he wanted to do? Okay. I hope what you want to do will be available when you get there.
Okay, do we have any more questions?
Yes, go ahead.
Sir, I was just
stand up and give your name so they know who you are.
Cadet Kern, sir. I was just curious if you could share your greatest leadership experience that you had.
Well, my greatest leadership experience,
yes, sir,
is what I'm doing now. I think I'm not leading you into combat. I'm leading you to the library and the books. That's why I'm here.
Well, I want to thank you once again, Lieutenant Colonel Woodhouse, for coming and visiting us here at Norwich. We are so grateful that you graced us with your presence today. So if we could have a hand one more time for
Thank you all for attending.
I'm thirsty for that right now.